Belinda Audiobooks presents this unabridged recording of No Standing Zone, written by Margaret Clark and read by Dino Marnika. Be sure to visit our website at www.belinda.com. Details of other available and forthcoming Belinda audiobook releases can be found at the end of this recording. The dedication reads, "For all the links out there in the human chain, for those who get it together and for those who get broken in the process, and for Bill, who wanted to smell the words." Chapter 1. Dad, mad, bad, sad, and I'm glad.
That kid's bad through and through.
He's not.
Listen, Jan, he's been bad since the day he was born.
Link focused on the TV, some weird movie about an avenging angel. He hunched forward, trying to drive the words, Dad's words, out of his head.
Bad since the day I was born. Was I really born mad, or did I get made bad?
When I was a little kid, I did stuff like drive Dad's car through a shop window, chucked apples onto the road and watched cars squash them, put the cat in the washing machine, bit all the other kids, painted my room with Mum's nail polish, cut Claire's hair off. Was that bad, or just experimental? Did Einstein cut his sister's hair off?
Link's parents were talking in the kitchen, and he could hear their voices floating down the hallway.
They were talking about him, yelling about him. Lincoln Francis Jamison, number one son, the only son.
Claire never gives us any trouble. Why can't Link be like her?
Claire, the sweet and shining older sister, bright, intelligent, nice.
She's a nice girl. Girls are different. Girls aren't so aggressive. They're not so hard to handle.
You know, Link's always been hard to handle. But this shoplifting thing wouldn't have happened if you were at home more often. He needs a father's influence, snapped his mother.
Wrong. Dad could make me glad and not bad.
No way, man. And here's news for you, Mum. There's good girls and there's bad girls. Claire's your daughter, beautiful and dutiful and good. But that's not Claire's fault. I love my sister Claire for being good. You can't help being given a good label, same as you can't help getting a bad one. Born bad? I've heard it often enough from Dad. So it must be true. You are what you hear, I hear. Bad boy, good girl.
Link shoved his hand into the nearly empty crisps packet, spilling some onto the carpet.
He'd get bagged for that too. He ground the chips into the carpet with his heel and kept munching, kept watching the idiot box as the voices grew louder.
My son! I never believed he'd do such a thing, shouted his father angrily. And it's not my fault either. Don't lay that one on me. It's your fault, Jan. You've spoiled him rotten.
Spoiled rotten? What's that saying about one rotten apple in the barrel spoiling the rest? Anyway, what's the hassle? I only nicked a crappy sweatshirt from a store on Jono's Dare. The store had hundreds of sweatshirts, all colours and sizes. I didn't rob a bank or bash up a little old lady. No big deal.
I haven't spoilt him rotten. It's you.
His mother's voice rose angrily.
You're never here. Always off on your business trips, bringing him back expensive stuff to make up for not being a real father.
I can't be in two places at once, Jan. If I don't travel, I don't get the contacts. If I don't get the contacts, the business doesn't grow. You want private schools for the kids? You want to live in a nice area? Money doesn't fall off trees, so don't blame me.
They're at it again. When Dad's not there, she moans about it. When he is, she does nothing but nag. And he's showing up less and less, looking tired, not wanting to talk and escaping as soon as he can onto the next plane to Hong Kong or wherever.
I want a divorce,
shouted his mother over the top of the Twisties commercial. Always her final words when she's losing the argument.
Divorce and a piece of paper that could slice up our lives. Way to go, Mum.
Yeah? Well, believe me, so do I, yelled his father. I'm sick and tired of coming home to this crap. You're always whining, and Link's nothing but bad news. He's no son of mine, that's for sure.
Link could picture them both. Dad standing looming over Mum as she slumped at the kitchen table, his hands squarely planted, brown eyes blazing with anger, and Mum in the subordinate position, looking up at him with cold blue eyes. Same blue eyes as Link. The kitchen was a good setting for a divorce. Sterile, sparkling clean, an all-white edifice by Paulie of Double Bay Interiors. Poncing poorly.
No son of mine. Screaming jets. Fine. Good. Who needs a father anyway?
Your father and I have decided to separate, said Mum the next day over breakfast. We're getting a divorce.
Link breathed in normality. Toast, eggs, orange juice, coffee. This couldn't be happening. But Dad was nowhere to be seen. He was probably jetting away into the clear blue yonder towards a new and childless life.
Good one, Dad.
Claire looked stunned. She blinked, then burst into tears. She was the kind of kid who always pretended that everything was cool. She was dark-haired with her father's dark eyes. Pretty and smart and very popular. Cheerleader material. A year older than Link. She'd been the only kid until he'd come along.
What's it like being shoved aside for someone else? A new baby?
I'll never know. Mum and Dad sure as hell aren't going to have any more kids, are they? Claire's eyes swam with tears. She was Daddy's girl. The baby chick, even though she was older.
She's the elder, but I'm the man of the house now. No, Dad, maybe I'm glad. No, I think I'm sad. But hey, I'm the cock of the walk. I'm the major rooster in this hen house.
Dad had really and truly gone, packed a couple of suitcases and left.
Maybe you could have tried harder, said Claire, looking at Mum. Been nicer to Dad.
Mum rolled her eyes to the ceiling. She pushed a well-manicured hand wearily through her shoulder-length bobbed hair.
When a marriage is over, it's over, she said.
Link stared at his toast.
Cold toast, cold marriage.
Marriage. Two people meet, they have the hots for each other, they do eye-gazing, they hold hands, they get engaged, they plan, they marry. The big white wedding bit, they have kids.
Maybe it was doomed from the start, said Mum,
pouring herself a cup of tea from the white Wedgwood teapot.
Our backgrounds are so different.
Two people from different backgrounds. Dad, the poor kid from the wrong side of town, marries Mum, the rich girl from the right side of town. How could it work? Some marriages like that must work. Not everybody gets divorced. But are they happy? Really happy? Do they just wish they could get divorced and plod along acting happy? Or are they having affairs? Jono's old man was having it off with another guy, and his mum found out. Instant screaming divorce. Worse than this stuff. Jono keeps wandering around muttering, "Me old man's a poof. What does that make me?"
What about school?
Asked Claire, all wide-eyed and worried. She loved Summerton, her all-girl private school.
Girl stuff. Phone calls the minute she walks in the door. How can girls be together all day then yak on for another 2 hours on the phone? Weird.
Your father will still pay your school fees, said Mum.
Good, said Claire. He should. He has a responsibility to make sure we're educated. Don't you think so, Link?
School? Who cares? Ridley College. It's just a building full of trapped bodies going somewhere to nowhere. But then school's a kind of comfort zone, a routine. Somewhere to go when there's nowhere to go. Basically, I'm only there for the sports. I want to finish Year 12 and get into the Institute of Sport and play cricket for Australia.
This shouldn't change your routines, said Mum. Your father and I are determined that you won't suffer because of this.
Suffer? My old man says I'm no son of his and they think I'm not going to suffer? Yeah.
Maybe I'm not going to suffer. Maybe this is going to be a barrel of laughs.
Will we have to give up the house? Asked Claire.
Mum frowned.
I don't know. I don't suppose your father can afford to keep paying for everything and get a place for himself. I guess that will all come out when we file for divorce.
File for divorce?
Rasp, rasp, rasp. They were eating breakfast a week later.
I've got something to tell you, and you're not going to like it, said Mum.
So, what's the good news?
Your father has, well, someone else. She's in New Zealand. This woman, Elise. He's been seeing her, staying with her for... They have a child, a four-year-old boy called Ben.
I've got a brother? Son of my father? I'm not the only son.
Shit, eh?
That's disgusting, said Claire,
banging her cup down with force onto the saucer.
He's been seeing another woman while he's been married, and our father and all, and they have a kid. Where does that leave us?
In a financial mess, said Mum. Your father says he's in debt up to his eyeballs. He made some bad investments, and we've got two mortgages on this house that have to be paid. We're going to have to sell and move somewhere cheaper.
Can he afford Somerton? I don't want to leave Somerton. He has to pay the school fees or I'll just die.
Hold it. You're worrying about school and we've just found out we've got a stepbrother? Mum looked grim. Don't worry. I'm hitting him for the school fees. He's still your father and it's his duty to pay for your education.
But I'm no son of his. He said so. And who's the fortunate son, eh?
Aren't you lot even curious about the other kid? What was his name?
Ben. Our flesh and blood.
I want to see him. I wonder if he was born bad. It could be in the genes, eh? Bad Ben.
Link, say something.
You're sitting there and this is your father we're talking about.
Biologically, yes. Lovingly, emotionally, a big fat no.
I'm still in shock, Mum. Another woman. A stepbrother called Ben. It's like one of those TV soapies.
I think Dad's a selfish pig, said Claire. He's totally upset our lives walking out on us. And he's off in New Zealand having a great time with his other little family. It's not fair.
Well, Claire, that's not nice, calling Dad a selfish pig. I'm the bad boy who's supposed to call him a boring bore. I've never heard you be mean and mad before. You're always so kind. You're always so good. Truly, you're a nice girl. A good girl.
I know, said Mum. Maybe Gramps can help us out.
Claire suggested, as she reached for the salt and absent-mindedly put a white frosting of it onto her lamb cutlet.
Out of character. Claire never puts on extra salt. Is this what a family breakup does? Changes the human spirit, the good girl, the salt of the earth.
Unfortunately, no. Your grandfather can't help right now. He invested in some bad stock and he's got a cash flow problem.
Cash flow problem? Salt flow problem? Life flow problem?
But I'm sure we'll manage. He'll help when things get better, but we'll have to sell this house and move, said Mum.
So long as it's not too far from Somerton. Oh, and Ridley, Link.
Yeah. Ridley. A school's a school. But I like this neighbourhood. We have to move. Thanks a lot, father of the Kiwi son, Ben, the other son, the fortunate one. Chapter 2. And moving right along.
Well, it's not what we're used to, but it'll have to do, said Mum, as the last of the furniture was moved into the rooms of the new house. I think it's horrid, said Claire.
Mum sighed. There's a shortage of houses, Claire, and this is all my money could buy. Be grateful that we at least have a roof over our heads. Link stared out the kitchen window. There were a couple of straggly trees and a hill's hoist tilted at a slight angle. It all happened so quickly. Dad said he had absolutely no money. He'd invested it in something that had gone bust.
Your grandfather thinks your father will have money squirreled away offshore, said Mum.
And when the lawyers find out where, your father won't know what's hit him. Mum really hates Dad now. And being an only child, she hasn't got anyone else except Gramps and Gran to turn to. And they hate Dad. So does Claire.
So do I.
We should start a universal Hate Dad's fan club and charge membership fees. We'd make millions.
Are we playing tennis tomorrow afternoon, Mum? Claire asked. The season hasn't finished yet, has it?
No, said Mum. I've resigned from the club.
But you're still having lunch at Arabella's with Ophelia, Lucy and Phoebe like you do every 6 weeks, aren't you? The 6 week club?
No, said Mum. I've outgrown the 6 week club. I'm going to join the local library. Most of her posh so-called friends have dumped her now. She can't keep up with them, go to lunches and dinner parties and stuff. She can't even afford to belong to the tennis club anymore. Certainly not the 6 week club. And Arabella's, where the food prices are indecent.
It was indecent the way Dad put our house straight on the market at that low price, said Claire.
It had been sold almost immediately, and now they had moved to Westlands. Mum's share of the house money had gone to help pay family debts, and this little house, this shabby little shitbox, was all they could afford.
A house in Westlands?
Commonly known at Ridley as Wastelands. Jono, quoting his father, said the people there were a waste of space. Quietly, Link walked out of the kitchen and down the hall to his bedroom. He stood near the window and stared out. Couldn't she have found something nearer the city? This is the arse end of the world. No harbour view here. Shame. I liked looking at the boats. Yachts, ferries, merchant ships coming in and out, and the cruisers. Even a couple of submarines. Always changing every time I looked out the window. Does this view ever change? There are houses. Some trees. Maybe they lose their leaves. It's so small, complained Claire, who was now also in her bedroom. It was down the hall. She was arranging her soft toys along the shelf. Same bedspread, same toys, same books, different bedroom. Link looked around his bedroom.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.